right? So I call this an out of order process, but so far everything has been happening in program order. Okay, now this is where the magic comes in. Okay, so the issue queue is a structure that finally will lead to out of order execution. Okay, in our earlier in order pipeline, we said that as instructions enter the pipeline, if there's a data dependence, then that instruction gets stalled at the decode stage, and everybody behind it also gets stalled. Okay, and that was the primary limitation of our in order processor. Okay, now in this out of order processor, the issue queue is the point where you decide if somebody is ready to proceed to the execution stages or not. Okay, so every cycle, the issue queue is going to look at every single entry in the issue queue. It's not just going to look at the first instruction and either push it forward or not. It's going to look at every single instruction in the issue queue, and it's going to see if that instruction has both of its input operands available or not. Okay, so let me, you know, since I've made a mess of this figure, let me just clear some stuff out. Okay, so every single cycle, I'm going to see if my input operands are available. Okay, so R1 and R2 are always available, right? So if you're referring to a register value, then you know for sure that the value is available. Okay, it's only the temporary registers that are unknown, because those are instructions that are currently working in the pipeline and they may not yet have produced a result. Okay, but if a value sitting in R1, it means that the instruction that produced that result has already committed. That means it's definitely finished and the value has been produced and written into R1. Okay, so anytime you refer to an actual register name, you know that that is available. It is the other temporary names that are a little bit more suspect. Okay, so now let's see if T1 is available. Well, it's not, because the instruction that is producing a value T1 is still sitting right here. It's still sitting in the issue queue, so definitely we don't have a value produced for T1. Same thing goes for T2 and, you know, and T4, right? So all of these other register names are unavailable. Okay, so the issue queue looks at all of these instructions. It says, well, the first instruction has R1 and R2 available, so let me now go ahead and issue it. Okay, so this instruction is chosen for issue. And in this case, it was the first instruction, so it's behaving no different than what an in-order processor might have done. Okay, but anyway, this first instruction gets selected, and it gets sent to the execution units. In this case, you need a simple integer adder, which will add R1 and R2. You need those input values, so there's one pipeline stage in between which is going to read values from R1 and R2. And then you do the math, produce a result. And then once you have a result, you will place the result back into this register T1 associated with the reorder buffer. Okay, in addition to writing the result in T1, you're going to send a broadcast to the issue queue saying T1 has just been produced. So anyone that needs the value of T1 can proceed. Okay, so the issue queue is going to do a quick check to see, you know, who is waiting for T1. This one's waiting for T1 and this instruction is waiting for T1. So great, in the next cycle, I will now see which instructions are ready for issue. The second instruction has both of its operands available, so this one leaves in the next cycle. Okay, and so it's going to read its input operands. It's going to read R3 from the register file. It's going to read T1 from down over here. And then it's going to do the math, produce a result. And then it's going to write the result into the reorder buffer T2. And it's going to send a broadcast to the issue queue saying now T2 is available. Okay, so everybody that is waiting for T2 sets this as being ready, this is being ready, this is being ready. Okay, so until now, our processor was not behaving very differently from an in-order processor. Right, you issued instruction 1 first, and then sometime later when the value is produced, you issued instruction 2. Okay, now there are more options. In the next cycle, when the issue queue examines the instructions, it says, well, instruction 3 has its operand available, and so does instruction 4. So now both of them can leave the issue queue in the next cycle. So both of them leave at the same time. And both of them, you know, since you have multiple ALUs, they can both execute together and, you know, both produce a result. The branch is not really going to update the reorder buffer, but it's going to confirm that the branch prediction was correct, in which case you proceed. If the branch prediction was wrong, then you have to squash every instruction that comes after that. Okay, so the reorder buffer after instruction 3 gets cleared out. The issue queue after instruction 3 gets cleared out. Everything in the instruction fetch queue also gets cleared out. Okay, but in this case, let's assume that the branch was predicted correctly. And so you carry on. And the fourth instruction is also working at the same time. It produces a result in T4, also sends out a broadcast saying T4 is available. So finally, this instruction has both of its input operands ready. It leaves in the next cycle and executes. Okay, so the issue queue is the smart unit over here, which says that, you know, I'm going to keep track of who has their operands available and who does not. And accordingly, I'm going to issue instructions. Okay, so the key innovation over here is that if some earlier instruction is stalled because of data dependencies, that should not prevent later instructions from executing. So if a later instruction has both of its operands available, you should be able to issue those. So let me show you an example of that. So if there's some later instruction which does, you know, R8 plus R9, when it gets renamed, it says, well, I'll produce a result in temporary storage T6. I'm dealing with values R8 and R9, which are already sitting in the register file. So in the very first cycle, when I chose the first instruction to issue, I could have also issued this instruction, right? So that last sixth instruction is not being limited by the fact that, you know, these instructions are all data dependent and will take a while to finish. Okay, so instruction number six also executes at the same time as instruction number one. And similarly, there could be instructions that depend on instruction six, right? And those can also issue pretty soon, right? So in the next cycle, this instruction which needs T6 will also issue at the same time as instruction number one. Okay, so that's really the heart of the pipeline now, this issue queue unit, which at runtime is going to figure out, you know, which instructions have operands ready and can issue in this very next cycle, which allows you to execute instructions, you know, 1, 6, 13, all at the same time, as long as you have enough ALUs to execute them. And as these instructions finish, they produce a result in the reorder buffer. Okay, so finally, the last step is to commit these results. Okay, so when the oldest instruction has produced a result in T1, that instruction is ready to commit, and it puts its value back into R1. Okay, which was the initial intended destination for that result. Okay, and then in the next cycle, T2 is now the oldest instruction, so it puts its result in this case into R2, and so on. Okay, so you can commit instructions in program order and make those results permanent. Okay, now every time a value is committed, you're essentially changing the name for that value. That value was named T1, and now it's being renamed back to R1. Okay, and there might be instructions in the issue queue which are still referring to T1. Okay, so all of those names have to now be changed. Okay, so you have to essentially go through the issue queue every time you do this commit to say that anyone that was referring to T1, well, you are now going to get your result from R1. Okay, so, you know, this is a little bit of a complex process. And in a later video, I'll show you how even that problem can be overcome. Okay, but as of now, you know, since the commit process involves yet another renaming step, you have to go through the issue queue to correct any names that are still referring to the old name. Okay, so once this has been fixed, this first reorder buffer entry is no longer in use, and T1 has been freed up. Okay, so if I've used up all of these six instructions, at this point, I have to stall my decode and rename stage because I have no more space to bring in the seventh instruction. But once the first instruction commits, I can now cycle over, and instruction 7 gets placed in this first entry, and it's going to use T1 as its destination. Okay, and this is why it is important to correct any references to the old T1, because now somebody else is going to produce a result in T1, and you have to make sure that you don't confuse your register names. All right, so, you know, these are the basics of what an out-of-order process does. There's obviously a lot more detail that I can go into, and I'll spell out some of these details in the next video.